say a little prayer and get ready to say that we're going to hopefully hear a message that's divinely inspired, because Lord help me, I hope it is. So how about we lock them and load them? Dear Heavenly Father, be with us today as we sit here. We hear your words. We are inspired by you. Help us to bear the fruit that we'll speak of. Help us to show others what it is to be a Christian. And we do all these things in your holy name. Amen. Well, this all kind of started last week, and it was a double whammy, as I like to call it. The first thing was, somebody walked up to me and said, well, what are you? And I wasn't sure what they were asking me. What was I? So quickly, I ran through what it is that I might be. Do I say I'm a mother, I'm a wife, I'm a student, I'm a churchgoer, I am a Yankee who's still trying to get through in the South? Is it that? And what denomination? Maybe they want to know what denomination I am. Well, I'm a disciple, and the person was still looking at me because thankfully this wasn't all coming out of my mouth. And I said, I'm a Christian. And then I thought, I'm a Christian. Well, I could say I'm a follower of the way. I could say that Jesus teaches me, and through him I get to Christ, I mean, to God. I could say all those things, but no, I'm a Christian is sufficient. And then I waited for that second question that so often comes. Well, what does that mean? You ever had someone ask you that? Think about it. If you just said, I'm a Christian, and someone said to you, what does that mean? How would you define yourself? And that was the moment of inspiration for me. What would I say to someone when I said I was a Christian? So I brought that question to my youth group, and I said to the 12, 13, and 14-year-olds, tell me, what is a Christian? And every single one of them said, I believe in God, or I believe in Jesus. Standard answer. And I thought, we owe them more, and we owe ourselves more. There's more to that definition than just, I believe in God, because that's kind of a given. So I thought, well, what does it look like to be a Christian? How do I live that out? What do I want kids to know? Or what do I want to be able to say? So I thought about Galatians 5, 22 and 23, fruit of the Spirit. And so I said, let's read this. So the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against such things. So the fruit is the byproduct of the Spirit at work in us. So I thought, why don't we use these words when we describe ourselves as a Christian? So a more powerful answer to that question would be, I work at loving others. I have joy that no one can ever take from me. I work at and desire peace. I show kindness to all. I am generous with not only my money, but my time. I want this world to be a better place when I leave here. I am faithful, that is unwavering. I am filled by the Holy Spirit, and I show and have faithfulness because I believe in the inherent worth and dignity of every human being. Gentleness, oh yes, how about that? Those sharp edges are worn down continually by my showing love and working towards peace. And finally, yes, I have self-control. Hope I'm not lying in church. Because my behavior should clearly show anyone who sees me that I live what I believe and it radiates through me. Would that not be a wonderful set of words to declare to someone when they say, are you a Christian? I am, and this is who I am. I want people to know who I am by my actions, not by a title. So let's be honest, all of that which I just said is extremely hard. You see, those lines of scripture that actually precede the ones that I said to you, those are the ones that we're most familiar with. They're called the works of the flesh. Have y'all heard of those? That scripture starts in line 16 in chapter 5 of Galatians, and it says, "Live by the Spirit, I say, and do not gratify the desires of the flesh. For what the flesh desires is opposed to the Spirit, and what the Spirit desires is opposed to the flesh. For those are opposed to each other, to prevent you from doing what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not subject to the law. Now, the works of the flesh are obvious: fornication, impurity, licentiousness, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, anger, quarrels, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and things like these. I am warning you as I warned you before, those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God." Yep, those are the behaviors and characteristics that seem so prevalent in this world today, are they not? Those are the things that we see most often, and in truth, sometimes in ourselves. That's where the world gets in our way. You see, maybe I should say sin, because anything that separates you from God is what gets in the way. The fruit of the word, or the fruit of the Spirit, is what we should be bearing. And the world we live in does not bear that fruit. I'm laughing. You want to know why? Y'all turn around once and take a look out there. They're all staring at us. It tickles me. I just wanted y'all to know. I was getting a little tongue-tied and twisted because I was watching the doors. Okay, so let's go on. I was not letting the Holy Spirit lead me. I was letting the world get in the way. All right. Anyway, in our hearts, in ourselves, there is a space that is truly carved out for the Holy Spirit to reside. That's given to us by just the fact that we believe in God. The Holy Spirit is in us. And that Spirit in you, residing in you, and having its presence there will cause you to bear that fruit. But you have to make room for the Spirit too. And in truth, you have to cultivate what matters in your life, and that fruit matters. Because otherwise, the world will take over, and it will squash out the room that should be made for the Holy Spirit. So we were talking about this in youth group, and one of the girls said, "Well, what about Hitler? How can you love Hitler?" And I do mean to tell you, I was stumped for a moment. I had to think about it, and I had to dig, and then I had to dig a little deeper. And finally I said to her, "I have compassion. I have compassion for Hitler, because I can imagine the child that he was, that was damaged so that he would grow into the man that he was. I have love for that child." And that got me thinking about so many other people where we think we hate them, we use harsh words, or you don't stand for what they believe in. But wouldn't it be better if we could find that thing in them that was for us to love? That's hard. Could you do it? Can you do it? I like the facial expressions right now. It is a challenge, but it's what we're called to do. Agape love. Love the way God loves us. So, after that, I think what we have to do is truly work hard at cultivating a space for that fruit. We have to clean room out for it. We have to utilize it and make sure that it's close enough to the forefront that we can use it. And that's hard work. Doing what's right instead of just what is easy is hard. We do it. We all do it. We choose the way of the world instead of the fruit of the Spirit too often. And we think we just can't, but we can. We need to use those fruits and make more room for them and not judge ourselves too harshly as we think we aren't capable of doing that. Loving unconditionally, showing gentleness, remaining faithful. We think of models of Christianity that are typically something we can't truly achieve. We can't be Jesus, but we can do the work he calls us to do. We aren't going to be a Mother Teresa, but we can be generous with our patience and our kindness and work at being peacemakers and not just peacekeepers. We need to remember that we are a work in progress and the best tools to use we have, and that's the fruits of the Spirit. We just need to use them. I read a poem by Carol Wimmer that was written in 1988, and it actually was reworked by Maya Angelou, who made it famous. Anyway, it talks about the fruit and the human condition working in and around us perfectly. It's called When I Say I Am a Christian. When I say I am a Christian, I'm not shout, I'm cleanly living. I'm whispering I was lost, now I'm found and forgiven. When I say I'm a Christian, I don't speak of this with pride. I'm confessing that I stumble and need Christ to be my guide. When I say I am a Christian, I'm not trying to be strong. I'm professing that I'm weak and need His strength to carry on. When I say I am a Christian, I'm not bragging of success. I'm admitting I have failed and I need God to clean my mess. When I say I'm a Christian, I'm not claiming to be perfect. My flaws are far too visible, but God believes I'm worth it. When I say I am a Christian, I still feel the sting of pain. I have my share of heartaches, so I call upon His name. When I say I am a Christian, I am not holier than thou. I don't wish to judge. You see, I have no authority at all. I only know I'm loved by the one who gave me the name, Christian. So what I think is, when you declare yourself a Christian, it's said with confidence and might. I am a Christian. And I am loving unconditionally. I am working toward peace. I am generous. I have faithfulness. I am kind and patient. I have joy that no one can steal. And I have self-control. It's hard to do all these things, but I am a work in progress because I am a Christian. At this point, I believe it's time to give us that lovely piece of spiritual food, that which sustains us through the week that we should be fueling up with. So Deborah, crawling on Deborah. Deborah's going to come up here and she will lead us in communion.
I'm gonna be just
the dark soil in your soul nurture seeds of great character, love, joy, faithfulness, compassion. That hidden beauty in your life will be brought to the light, and the fruit from enduring that journey from those hidden places will be a blessing to many. Water each other's soil with encouragement and truth. Let everyone see the fruit of your spirit. Amen.